In part two of our lesson on graphs of sine and cosine, we will be extracting the graph of sine from the unit circle. Now first, let's remember that on the unit circle there are three variables. Going around the unit circle is s, which we know is actually equivalent to theta. They're numerically equal on the unit circle. So you can think of this as s going around the unit circle or theta going around the unit circle. Now at each point on the unit circle, wherever you happen to be, we know that the x value will give us the cosine of s and the y value will give us the sine of s. So those are the three variables: s, x, which is cosine s, and y, which is sine of s. Now what we're going to do is extract from this unit circle, which has three variables, and create a graph in the xy coordinate plane that has only two variables. So first we will extract the graph of y equals sine of x from the unit circle. And the way we'll do that, first, let's start off by getting all of these values of the quadrantal angles. And you can use this diagram of the unit circle to help you do that. It's CYU time, so pause the video, work the example on your own, then restart the video to check your answer. So we know that the sine of 0 is 0, the sine of pi over 2 is 1, the sine of pi is 0, sine of 3 pi over 2 is negative 1, sine of 2 pi, 0. Now going in the negative direction, we know that negative pi over 2 is here, coterminal with 3 pi over 2. So the sine is going to be negative 1. Negative pi is coterminal with pi, so we know the sine is going to be 0. Negative 3 pi over 2 is coterminal with pi over 2, so we know the sine is going to be 1. And negative 2 pi is coterminal with 0, where the sine will be 0. Now let's take all of these values and plot them in the xy coordinate plane, where the x value is going to be the argument of the sine function. So instead of being s on the unit circle, the argument will be x in the coordinate plane. So since the sine of 0 is 0, that means we come down here on the coordinate plane and plot the point 0, 0. Next, we have the point pi over 2, comma 1. Then we have pi, 0, 3 pi over 2, negative 1, and 2 pi, 0. In the negative direction, we have negative pi over 2, negative 1. We have negative pi, 0. We have negative 3 pi over 2, 1, and negative 2 pi, 0. So now let's find out what the shape of this graph will be. As a point travels around the unit circle, its y value gives us the sine of s. So sine of 0 starts out at 0, until we get to pi over 2, where sine of pi over 2 is equal to 1. Then sine decreases until we get to pi, where sine of pi is 0. Then it goes negative until at 3 pi over 2, the sine is negative 1. And then it increases back up to 0 at 2 pi. So we can go ahead now and draw in the sine wave. We have a better idea of what its shape is like. And one thing to notice is that there are no straight lines anywhere on this graph. It's all a smooth curve from one key point to the next key point. No straight lines. There shouldn't ever be kind of a sawtooth looking graph. It'll never look like that. It's always these smooth curves. This is one cycle of the graph, and we know if we went around in the opposite direction, it's just going to behave in a similar way, making these smooth curves. We can draw it in the negative direction now. And here we've created our graph of y equals sine of x. Next, we want to answer some questions about this graph. First, let's take a look at the period. We see that this is indeed a periodic function because it repeats itself. And we can use an endpoint to a starting point subtraction to determine the period. You can see this is an entire cycle here, starting at 0 and going to 2 pi. So if we take the x value of 2 pi and subtract the x value of 0, we can see that the period is equal to 2 pi. Now, because the point on the unit circle can rotate around forever and ever and ever, this graph is going to go on forever and ever, repeating itself in both the positive direction and in the negative direction. So the domain is all the possible x values, so we can have all the x values going out to positive infinity and all the x values coming in from negative infinity. So the domain is going to be negative infinity to positive infinity. The range, we have to give the resulting y values, and we see that the smallest y value we can ever get is negative 1. The biggest y value we can ever get is positive 1. So the range of this graph is negative 1 to 1. Now, min refers to minimum value, so the minimum value always refers to a y value, so the minimum is negative 1. The maximum value it takes on is positive 1. And normal cycle refers to what are we going to use as our standard one cycle of sine. And what we're going to use is the cycle that starts at 0 and ends at 2 pi. So our normal cycle is going to go 0 to 2 pi. So let's label the normal cycle right on our graph here. We're going to use the piece of the graph that starts at 0 and ends at 2 pi as what we're going to refer to as our normal cycle. And we can see that there are 5 key values. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And every sine graph that you create will have those 5 key values. So it always starts off here at 0, 0, which is a root. There's also a root here at pi 0. And it ends with a root here at 2 pi 0. The second key value here is a maximum, which occurs at pi over 2, comma 1. And the fourth key value is a minimum, which occurs at 3 pi over 2, negative 1. Now, every graph that you create of the sine will go through these five key values. They will all go root, max, root, min, root. And they may be stretched or shifted, compressed, expanded, but they will all be some version of that. The y value is always going to go 0, 1, 0, negative 1, 0. We'll explore that further in the next section when we do transformations of the graph. Next, we are being asked to determine whether y equals sine of x is an even or odd function. Now, we know that the test for odd function is if f of negative x is equal to negative f of x. So let's look at the graph and see if that's true. If we look at sine of negative pi over 2, we know that that is negative 1. And what we're going to check to see is if that is equal to the opposite of the sine of pi over 2. Now we know that the sine of pi over 2 is positive 1, so we're taking the opposite of positive 1. This is a true statement, so it's pretty easy to see that sine of x is going to be odd. Another way that you can determine if a function is odd is to look at its graph. If the graph is symmetric to the origin, then we also know that that graph is odd. Now, an easy way to look at a graph and tell if it's symmetric to the origin is if you can fold the graph over both axes and it lands on top of itself. So if we take sine of x, say the positive side of the graph, if we take sine of x and fold it over the x-axis and then fold it over the y-axis, it lands right on top of itself. So that is another way that we know that sine of x is odd. So both of these ways, we can either do the test of the function or we can look at the graph. So sine of x is odd. Now we're being asked to find an equation which names all the roots of y equals sine of x. Now remember that a root of a function is where the y value is equal to 0, or another way of saying that is where f of x is equal to 0. It's where the graph crosses the x-axis. Now there's a couple different names we can use. We can call it a root. We can call it an x-intercept. Or we can call it a zero of the graph. All of those are valid names for where the function value is equal to 0. Now, when we look at our graph, we see that it has roots at negative 2 pi, negative pi, 0, pi, and 2 pi. So then we think of how can we name all of these, because there's going to be infinitely many, because remember, the graph goes on in both directions forever and ever and ever. So it doesn't just stop at 2 pi. The next root would be at 3 pi or 4 pi, or 5 pi, or 6 pi, or going in the negative direction, negative 1 pi, negative 2 pi, negative 3 pi, negative 4 pi. So that's why we need an equation, because we can't possibly list all the infinitely many roots that there are. So we notice that all these roots are just integer multiples of pi. So the roots of y equals sine of x are going to occur when the x value is an integer multiple of pi. And remember, we let n equal an integer.